just one too many. When I think what could be if we let our hearts believe.
Focused on the community and coordinating our services so we can give the best care possible to children and families and adults in Maricopa County.
It's a flat miracle that somebody like this is just sitting here today. That's just a miracle that's sitting on the TV screen.
I do feel like a walking miracle because I've been not only able to achieve peace, but also growing.
You guys are just so special. I've never met anybody like you guys. I just thank you from the bottom of my heart. And I know that all my family is so, so blessed.
We are the Rodriguez family, and we just want a 6-bedroom house.
Yay!
That it takes just one, could turn this all around. And if we live in history,
welcome to Seeing the Need, Finding the Solution. My name is Phil McIlveen, I'm your host. And Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays to everybody out there. Thank you for tuning in. Today we have a very special guest on our show as well, and some new guests. Ken's been here before. This is Ken Lewis, this is from Native American Connections. Welcome, Ken. And now I'll let you introduce your guest first.
Okay, this is Genevieve Shepherd.
Genevieve Shepherd, welcome.
Hello.
And I'm going to try to get this right here. This is Raul Espericueta.
That's right.
Get it?
Yes.
And Raul, you are with Friendly House. You're the president and CEO of Friendly House. So we're going to kind of start out with you. Friendly House, tell us a little bit about it.
It's a 92-year-old charity, Phil, that was founded by a group of concerned citizens in 1920. And their desire was to provide Americanization services for new immigrants. So we've been around for 92 years helping people become Americans. Through the citizenship process, by providing English classes, citizenship classes, legal assistance for new and potential immigrants. And in addition to that, over the 92 years, it's become an expansive social service agency, including education services for people in the Southwest.
And you know, right off the top of my head, what I love about that right out of the beginning is God has no borders, so everybody that's out there. I love what you do. You guys have an awesome tamale thing you guys do. I did some little research, and I don't want to focus on that, but it is, I don't know how many years it's been running, but it's been a lot. You have it down by the Patriot Square?
Well, it's actually going to be at Heritage. Square this spring. And it's probably the oldest running annual event in the valley. Mm-hmm. And we hope to really mix it up this year by having a tamale cook-off and invite restaurants from local municipalities to sure. send in their best tamale and have it judged by the valley's mayors. So it's what we intend to do. We have some of the mayors that have signed up already to come and judge the best tamale of the valley. And we use these funds, of course, to support the important services we have at Friendly House to meet the growing need and demand for the types of things that we provide.
So if you had to pinpoint, and on your screen you see the website for Friendly House as well, If you had to pinpoint what is really dear to your heart, every organization has something kind of that they're focusing on at this time. What is that you're focusing on the most right now as an agency?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, Phil, you know, our services are quite varied, so it's difficult for me to single out one as being more important than the other. But I think everyone recognizes that education is certainly vital in our community, and it's through the means of education that people are able to ultimately succeed. But one of the strengths of our organization is that we, when we provide these services, because of the other types of things that we do, like provide, say, mental health counseling or emergency food boxes or rental assistance or work training and or workforce development, we're able to provide for our clients a broad array of services that will help them to address whatever needs or opportunities they have to improve themselves. So things are I would say, you know, evolve or revolve around our educational services, but as we meet people and find out what they need or what opportunities they have, we're able to access for them additional services.
You just had an anniversary, correct?
As an organization?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Well, 92 years old, yes.
92 wow. years old. Wow. How amazing is that, and being able to sustain that long, especially with all the ups and downs that go through that type of service and behavioral health, and even as a nonprofit, period. That is very, very amazing. Bring to light helping people heal and recover. Some of the talking points that you wanted to cover is the opportunity to heal and acknowledging that. Go ahead and share a little bit about that.
Phil, I think that one of the most important, if not the most important step in recovery, whether a person has an addiction or if it's not an addiction, but they may have some type of mental health issue, is the recognition that there is an issue, that there is an opportunity for somebody to heal. It tends to be the largest stumbling block that we face. And I think that the reason that we tend to fear that is because, you know, when you make that recognition and when you step up and bring your issue or opportunity to the light, it gets difficult before it gets better. And the reason, what I mean by that is that, you know, when you have to face anything that's challenging your life, it usually isn't a peaceful process necessarily. That's not the word that I would use for it. It's a process by where you have to look in honesty at some of the things that may be troubling in your life and how they're affecting you. But that's the biggest step. And once that's done and the person's situation is brought to the light, so to speak, it enables the person to begin to experience the eventual freedom that comes from that.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you know, one of the things that I've talked about a lot in the past and sitting on that side of the table, especially in recovery mode, there's a lot of different services and agencies out there, but like Raul, a lot of people don't know the knowledge of that. You know, when you get into elements of even recovery and recovery rooms and the level of anonymity as part of the principles, it grows from the inside out. So I can't tell you even personally, but how many people want to get healthy, want to heal, but don't know how, don't know where to look. They're not in that element of where everything is available to them. So education, what an important part in being able to try to get that message out. If there's some place that you can go, or that different avenues of services, the rental assistance that you're talking about, or the education, or the counseling, or that wrap type of services around that individual, treating the whole person, mind, body, and spirit as well. Family services and that crisis council. Let's talk a little bit about that.
The United Way supports our crisis counseling program, and we're very grateful to all the Valley's contributors to United Way, because through these funds, we're able to provide important crisis interventions for people that come to our organizations. And I really encourage people in the community to access organizations like ours when they're facing issues with their families. If a person comes to us, you know, with a particular crisis, and say that there's ultimately an alcohol addiction, and we don't have an alcohol treatment facility, a residential treatment facility, but something that we can do is to be able to identify for that family the need that may exist for that person or someone in their family to access that kind of service, and then make sure that it happens. So we're the initial stop, and sometimes we're the last stop for people who have a crisis. But regardless, we want them to come and to meet with one of our counselors so that they can bring their situation to the light, as I said earlier, and make it known and begin the process of healing.
Question I always ask somebody who's come on the show for the first time. We have a lot of people, repeat people that come on the show. Tie off, coat off, hat on, t-shirt, pair of shorts. Why do you do what you do? CEO, executive director aside, why do you do what you do?
You know, Phil, I'm at Friendly House now as the president and CEO, and it happens to be in the neighborhood where I grew up. And when I was a child, I accessed the services at Friendly House. When I was 19 years old, I wanted to vote because I'm from Mexico, and I was an immigrant, a permanent resident immigrant, and I wanted to become naturalized. So I went to Friendly House and had my application completed so that I could become a citizen. And I worked there during college in the summers to help pay for my tuition. And postgraduate school, I worked there as the director of youth and family services, running that program for about 4 years. And 27 years later, I returned as the CEO back to my neighborhood across the street from the church where I grew up. So I'm back at Friendly House because I believe that this organization provides an important mission in our community. It's longstanding, it's necessary, and it affords people like me an opportunity to give back to our community and do something significant. I don't have the profile to succeed, if you look at my background, but there were people that believed in me, and my parents believed in me, and by God's grace and their assistance, I've been able to have a successful career, and now back in this position, give back to the organization that helped me become a citizen many years ago. Wow. So it's in my DNA,
absolutely,
you know, to have this position. I'm a social worker by profession, and I was a professor of social work at the School of Social Work at ASU for several years. And this is what I studied to do, and I'm doing it, and I'm happy to do it.
That's called restoration. We'll be back with Kent Lewis, Genevieve Shepherd, right after this moment. Stick around.
STAR is Stand Together and Recover Centers. This is our 25th year in existence. We are the oldest peer-run recovery center in Arizona. We do so many different things. We work with adults with mental illness, and we have support groups, independent living skills. We teach a person who often isolates to get back socially, to interact, to communicate well, to reestablish relationships with friends and family, to develop work skills, and to minimize the effects of their mental illness.
Diversified Roofing, one of the largest roofing specialists in Arizona. Protect your home with the highest quality tiling repair, maintenance, and shingling in the Southwest. Our commercial division provides businesses the highest grade roof installations, re-roofing, and repair or replacement solutions. Diversified Roofing has been safeguarding the community from disasters and severe weather, as well as serving it since 1988. Diversified Roofing. Visit us at diversifiedroofing.com.
Carry Me 123, the versatile ski rack that makes hauling skis, snowboards, poles, and lumber easy. No need for a permanent rack system, is ideal for small cars and people on the go. Perfect for family and trips, winter, fall, spring, and summer. Carry Me 123 is perfect year-round.
Native American Connections has been building healthy communities throughout Arizona for nearly 40 years. Our first-class services are designed to help people by improving the quality of their lives. Whether the challenge is substance abuse, mental health, or housing issues, Native American Connections cares. We are here to help. Everyone needs an affordable, safe place to live. Remember us when you are seeking housing opportunities that support your needs. Visit our website at nativeconnections.org, your partner in building healthy communities.
Spend all your time waiting for that second chance, for a break that would make it okay.
We are 100% committed to preventing suicide.
To feel not good enough.
We represent 100%.
We represent 100%.
We represent 100%.
We represent 100%.
There's no stigma or discrimination against the heart, the liver, the kidney, even the gallbladder. Doesn't even have a job.
Yesterday, depression was kept in the dark.
And bipolar disorder was your best friend's mother's problem.
But the tide is turning.
We're stopping the stigma.
We're coming out.
Our goal is to make the discussion of mental dis-ease cool and trendy.
No kidding?
Me too.
No kidding.
Me too.
No kidding.
Me too.
It's time we gave the all-American brain some peace of mind.
This one goes out to the man who minds for miracles. This one goes out to the ones in need. This one goes out to the sinner and the cynical. This ain't about no apology. We weren't born.
Seeing the Need, Finding the Solution, Sundays on AZTV.
Welcome back to Seeing the Need, Finding the Solution. For more information, make sure you go to Friendly House's website. You can go to azTV.com, click on the logo, it'll take you right over there. See how you can either get involved or get treated or get help or just be a part of. Ken Lewis, Native American Connections. Ken, tell us a little bit about Native American.
Thank you, Phil. Native American Connections was founded in 1972. We actually just celebrated our 40-year anniversary. We're under the leadership of Dee Dee Yazzie Devine. She's been with the agency for about 32 years. Under her leadership, we provide substance abuse treatment for youth and adults. We also get into the affordable housing, and we have seven housing communities that we can provide housing to.
And how important is that these days?
Oh, very. Yeah. What we found early on was that we could do the substance abuse treatment, but in recovery, as you know, there's much needed support. So when a lot of individuals were going home, they didn't have that true support. So with our housing communities, we wrap services, programs, resources that help to stabilize the individual and the families.
Which, for those of you who might not understand that, when Ken says wrap, he's trying to let you know he's taking multiple things to help somebody and wrap around that person to treat the whole person, which is something I know that they're very involved in with that mind, body, and spirit, and that treating the whole person, not just certain areas of it. Genevieve, welcome.
Hi.
Thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing part of Stories of Healing and Hope, which we do every year.
Thank you.
Genevieve, take us back to before you had the chance of being sober, I guess would be the word, before you had peace, what it was like back then for you. I mean, at the point that it was the most hardest for you.
It's like a dead end. You come to a dead end of your existence, and you feel like, you know, there's nothing left in this world, and the only resurrection I had was just to search. You know, I had nobody, and, you know, lost. And the only escape was, you know, continue to escape those hurt and the feelings from my past, is just to cover it with alcohol all the time. And
so alcohol was your
alcohol,
main?
Alcohol, yeah. I became a chronic alcoholic.
As much as you want to share and feel comfortable with as well as, for those women out there that can maybe relate to you today, some of that pain, if you can touch on it or whatever way you feel comfortable, but share some of that, because we'll get into the healing part of it as
well. Oh, when I see them walk in, you know, I remember, you know, and it just brings me to tears sometimes to see them walk in And a lot of times, you know, when I walked in, I remember thinking, no one understands. And when I see them walk in, I always let them know that, you know, I understand how that feels. You know, no matter what I look like now, no matter where I work at now, I remember being in your shoes. I share that with them, you know, and bring that comfort in. And so they can, you know, be calm when they come into our residential treatment facility.
For you personally, when you're relating to a client, you're relating to somebody else, and from a recovery standpoint, I know when I went to look for a sponsor, I tried to find somebody that had stuff in common with me. What is one of probably many things that you notice with people coming in that you can relate to in reference to what they've been through, very specifically? What is one thing that you can relate to them that they you see them coming in with? What type of pain, what cause?
The cause of it a lot of time is your family shuts you out because of your addiction, and you know, you're a nobody. You feel like you come in as a nobody.
And as a woman, is there physical, what's more prevalent, physical abuse? What types of physical aspects can you relate to?
I wasn't physically abused or in any way. It's just that as a woman, I was raised as a lady. My mother raised me as a lady until, you know, when she passed away from her drinking, I just stepped right into her shoe, you know. You hear people saying, I will never be like my mother. But I feel like when she passed away, I stepped right into her shoes. And when these women come in, and I know, I just know where they're at, you know. And I, there's no way of, from the beginning, there's no really way of comforting them until, you know, you really sit down and you can't just invade their, you know, their area.
So your last day drinking, or that you, your last week.
I remember.
Tell me about it.
It was like 2 days before I drank, and I had DTs. I had it bad. I had delirium tremors. And usually I go to the hospital, they would shoot me up, and I'd be calm.
How much alcohol were you consuming?
Oh, I was consuming like, when I drank like, maybe a case of beer. I didn't never drink whiskey, but believe me, when you're drinking beer, it accumulates and it gets in your system. It got to me so bad to where I was shaking at a time. I was walking around homeless with walking pneumonia, kidney infection. And I felt like, you know, I'm not gonna go to the hospital this time because I'm ashamed to walk back in there and ask for another shot to help me. This time I really want to sober up. It's what my story was when I walk in every time. But I'd walk back out and right back to Circle K again. But this time I said, I'm gonna do this. So anytime I have a challenge in my life, I remind myself of what I said that first time. I'm gonna do this. I can do this. And so I say that, you know, I share it with these women that walk in. I let them know. I remember saying, I can do this. And I got out of it. You know, it took me days and days for physically the DTs to wear off, but I did it. I did it because I did it for me. I said, I'm gonna do this for Genevieve.
You know, in that alcoholic state active addiction, that hopelessness and that utter demoralization, as they call it. Did you go to an agency to get help, how did you get sober?
I was on the streets, and you know, I met my dad in, and I was like.
So that was your bottom.
Yeah.
You were homeless.
Yep.
You were sick. You
yep.
had infections. You got
yep.
medical issues
yep.
going on, and a disease
hungry.
Called alcoholism.
Yeah. Yep. I was everything in the book, and I was walking. I know God works in my life a lot. I never believed it, but I did. When I was walking, I said, I gotta look for some Native Americans to feel better, to feel like I'm at home again, you know? So I walked. As I was walking, I saw the sign that said Native American Connections. And I went in there and I said, I need help. I need something right now. And they told me, you know, the first time they told me, well, you got to make an appointment. And I'm like, oh, now I got another reason to drink.
Sure.
But the second time, that was really, really my rock bottom. And I said, I'm going to go back over there. I'm really going to ask for help. I walked in there. I had no shoes on. I was hungry. And I told them, I really need help, and I'm begging. And they got me in. And I remember, you know, that walk, they fed me. The first thing they did is took me in. They fed me. And, you know, they gave me shoes. And that's where I first started my program. I was introduced to the Sweat Lodge, you know. And
and you've been with Native American Connections for how long?
7 years.
7 years. And you are now Guiding Star Women's Residential Treatment Center.
Yes.
That's where you work as an employee.
Yes.
If you could say one thing out there to the woman, to that camera, who still suffers like you did, what would you tell?
I'd have to say, you know, you're not alone. We understand. We know where you are. And we encourage you to call us. We encourage you to take that risk, to ask for help. Take that risk. That's what it took me. I took that risk, and I asked for help.
Ken, for the gentleman out there, real quick, we've got about 30 seconds before Raul. What would you like to tell everybody this holiday season?
That you do heal. That once you make that first step of wanting recovery, true recovery, getting on your knees and reaching out, you know, it is possible. Miracles do happen.
And Raul, for the 19-year-old kid in his neighborhood that is lost, what would you tell him?
We're here. There's always somebody here. There's a reason to press on, to continue, and there are people that care.
My name is Phil McIlveen, and we're talking to you about a specific needs in our community. There's a lot of mental illness. One out of every four persons are diagnosed with mental illness and seriously mentally ill. And even growing populations and veterans coming home and housing issues and funding cuts and people from these agencies having the blessing of being restored and also being able to give services back to another person who still suffers. Go to the websites for Native American Connections and also with Raul's website as well from Friendly House. Please make a phone call. It's tax season as well. Make donations. This holiday season, you can help another individual that hurt just like you, that went through exactly the way you did, but didn't have a chance to sit in the seat today and wound up dying. My name is Phil McIlveen. Merry Christmas.
I know you're there when I can't feel you. I will not fear. I will trust in you, and I will not be afraid. When the battle is close at hand, I know you're with me to help me stand. I will trust in you, and I will not be afraid. I will not be afraid. Trust in you.